What's up, folks? It's Cole Heads, buried in the net, superstar of the universe. And listen, y'all, I'm so excited about this interview. And it's just really a testament to how what's supposed to happen will happen. I was supposed to have another guest on this evening. We were supposed to. Wait a minute, hold on. We got some other sound happening in the background. We got to turn this down. I'm sorry, y'all. This is the weekend. There we go. All right, we all set now. So we were supposed to have another guest on this evening, and they weren't able, so I was able to call in a favor to a friend at the last minute, and this will be just as exciting a show. Today, my special guest is Mr. Cato Hammond. He is an author. He's a go-go historian. He's a musician. And so many other things that we're going to get into this evening. But before we do that, I have to take care of the sponsors. So, tonight's show is brought to you by Red Creations. You can find him at www.redzcreations.com and Twig Together Wealth Investment Group. You can reach them at 443-871-3514. Red Creations is a they make soaps, they make body butters, they make oils and sprays and candles. Just smell good for your body, smell good for your house. So if you are interested in getting any of their products, you can go to the website, which is listed right there on the screen. And then Together Wealth Investment Group is a trusted and reliable source for financial literacy, in particular with the Bitcoin industry. So check them both out. The number is listed there right on the screen. And as always, so anybody that's watching at the sound of my voice, like the pastor says, would you please like, share, and subscribe to my channel here. Like, I'm relatively new here on Facebook, but I'm not new to you. I know that. So I'm just switching over here to YouTube. So I need you to subscribe to me. I need you to like this video and to share the video so folks know I'm over here with these with the Cohan's Biz Show rather than on Facebook, okay? We may do a giveaway tonight with one of our sponsors if we get a chance to. So also, I like if you would to support the Cohan's Biz Show so we can keep the lights on and all of the other things that need to happen here. It's not cheap to do these shows even on a basic level. You know, I need software and, you know, keep software up and just keep it functioning. So all of my Cash App, Venmo, Zelle is at the bottom of the screen. If any of what is happening is adding value to your entertainment purposes, please support the Cole Hansberry Show, okay? And so without further ado, I'm going to bring on our guest, Mr. Cato Hammond. Let's see here. There we go. Welcome to the show, Mr. Hammond.
Hey, what's up, Cole? Thanks for everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, I can hear you just fine.
Thanks for the invite, man.
So, listen, I'm really excited about the show. It was coming down the line, but I'm glad that you was able to step in at the last minute and saved me. And I know you heard, like, the, I know you heard the panic in my voice earlier.
Yeah.
It's because, listen, let me tell you. When you set out to try to do something and you have set your mind to do it, it's like you have to try until all else fails, you know? And I thought about a few other people and stuff, and I'm just glad you came through for me. And you have known me ever since I was 10 years old.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
We met in a young people's performing company called the Children's Urban Art Ensemble. And that was before you became a go-go star. You were a go-go star in the making at the time. And now you are all out, I will say, a legend. But I think sometimes you are a little unsung for everything you do, though.
Right. Well.
What do you think?
I don't know. I just do what I do. I mean, it's what everybody going to view it differently. So I just do what I do and hope that whatever I've been doing has contributed to it. So, you know, that's kind of how I look at it. I don't, you know. And as long as I'm able to continue to do it as much as, you know, God give me the ability to be able to do, then I'm cool.
Right. So, let's start from the beginning. So, like I said, I knew you from the Children's Urban Art Ensemble, and so you have a theater background as I do. And we were trained in all different areas. So that's singing, dancing, and acting. So, you know, at least if we go into audition, we can present in all three areas to some capacity, you know. What did you do anything artistically before Q?
Yeah, I mean, man, shucks. First of all, I picked up my first guitar when I was probably like 8 or 9 years old. And just got really attached to music then. I mean, really, like, heavily hooked. I mean, you couldn't help but, and this is actually pre-go-go, so definitely pre-Q. And so I was, you know, learning how to, you know, at the age of 11, 12, trying to play in bands and trying to, you know, do the thing with the music thing. And what happened is, by the time I'm in ninth grade, and 14 years old in the ninth grade, I auditioned to get into a school, Duke Ellington School of the Arts. So before I went to Q, are you still there? I don't even know if you're still there. Wait a minute. Let me find out what's going on. We may not even be on the air. Was it just me? Are you there?
Yes, I guess I am. I went out for a minute and I'm back, and I don't know. We aren't getting a good signal here or something. I don't know if it's my end or.
Yeah, because I was talking, but the screen, it went black for a minute. And
I can't even hear you at all.
You can't hear me? 1, 2, check 1. 1, 2, hold on. 1, 2. I don't know what's going on here. And now you froze. Yeah, I think you're is it you or me? I can't tell. Wait a minute. me close a couple of things. Because it's saying that, nah, should I go out and come back? Okay, this is weird. This is weird. It says I'm in the show. Okay, if I do that, okay. Let me find out what's going on. Also, I need this. And I feel kind of naked out here. I don't know what's going on. Let me see. Let's see what's up. Yo. Yeah, because I think you want me to go off because I think this thing still got me on live.
Oh, yeah, stay on.
Stay on? Yeah. Okay, I'll just sit here and. All right. That's weird. That's really weird. Should I grab my guitar and play while I'm waiting? Fuck. Shit. That's all I can do, huh? Yeah, I guess I'll play my guitar till they come. What in the world is going on? So yeah, Cole Hansberry got me on here, but he's having internet problems, connection. And I just shut him down for a minute, but he wanted me to stay live until he comes back. I don't know what to do, so I just grabbed my guitar. What else to do? I was working on something earlier.
And we back.
Man, I grabbed my guitar waiting on you.
Okay, I appreciate that. I don't know what happened with the internet. It has been acting really crazy, but thank you. Thank you for keeping it going while I was gone.
It was better than sitting
So I don't know, and I hope it don't start doing the same thing. You say something?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
You can hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you. So, I was asking, because I didn't hear, and I don't know whether the audience heard. I was asking, okay. Were you doing anything creative before Q happened?
Right. Oh, so you didn't hear any of that?
I didn't hear any.
Okay. Well, like I said, before Q happened, first of all, I was 16 when I joined Q. 15 or 16. But, you know, I first picked up my first guitar, music, you know, So I was doing creative stuff in music probably since around the age 9 and 10. Picked up my guitar, you know, playing in little bands around the area. And yeah, at the age of 12 and all that, and, you know, all the way up to 14 in junior high school. And then what happened is I hooked up right after junior high school. I auditioned. So I auditioned and I started going to Duke Ellington School of the Arts.
Mm-hmm.
And so, of course, yeah, 15 and 10th grade, started going there. That's kind of around the same time I'm also being introduced to go-go on a larger scale. And I met, while at Duke Ellington, I met folks who were members of Q. So I found out from Q while at Duke, you know, people like Charnita and Talanda and all them. So I was in theater in Duke Ellington. I wanted to be there in music, but I found out when I was auditioning that I had to know how to read, and I didn't know how to read music. So I went to Duke for theater. Met, like I said, China and Talanda and Sherry and all that. And they taught me about Q. And then I auditioned, and that's how I got Q. So I was already, you know, going towards that arts type of field anyway during that time.
Right. So so the bands that you were doing, were they go-go bands?
No, this is pre-go-go. Like I said, at the age of 12, I was 12 in 1977. So I'm playing in a band in 1977, and go-go probably around that time was just, it wasn't even known as a music thing. It was an event thing that was going on with groups like Chuck Brown and the Soul Searchers, and other groups like the Young Senators, and they were playing around that our parents was going to see them at events called they called them go-go's. They were just like cabarets. So, but right. The music hadn't, you know, the music that was created by Chuck and the Soul Searchers really hadn't come into fruition just yet. You know what I'm saying? To the point where everybody else started playing it as well. That came a couple of years later. For example, like I said, I was 12. In 1977, my first time seeing a go-go band was when I was 14 in 79. So around that time, that's when bands like Red Essence and Trouble Funk and EU, they didn't start off as go-go bands either. They just started changing their style of playing music, you know. And that's how right around the time I started going to Duke Ellington, that's why I said, that's when I started getting emerged with the go-go thing too. But in the beginning, no, everybody was just playing. Back then, it was called Top 40. You know, now they call it playing cover. Yeah.
So, turning into go-go, like right before, did it still have like a go-go sound to it as we know it, or were y'all just playing it like?
Well, you got to keep in mind we're talking the 70s, so music was heavily percussive driven anyway. Well, not percussive driven, but had heavy percussion. Right. I mean, if you listen to any groups, whether you're talking Earth, Wind and Fire or Mandrill or War or Brass Construction or any of them kind of groups, they, you know, they were heavy with percussion. One thing you got to say about DC was always, as long as I can remember, which is why probably I got into, you know, was so entranced by DC, always had live bands. I mean, everywhere you look, in every neighborhood, there were live bands. So the whole style of that pattern of go-go, you know, wasn't exactly what they were doing. That was just a pattern that Chuck actually picked up basically from a Grover Washington song called Mr. Magic. And the beat, if you listen to the beat of Mr. Magic, that beat go boom, cut, boom, boom, cut, boom, boom, cut,
right.
Boom. Now he equated that with, you got to keep in mind, that's the basic go-go beat. If you keep that in mind, That basic go-go beat is really a gospel beat that's slowed down. In other words, if I took that basic beat, that boom, cat, boom, boom, cat, boom, boom, cat, boom, you know, if I did that and I sped it up, it would go the same pattern, boom, cat, boom, bagata, boom, cat, boom, bagata, boom, bagata, boom, bagata, boom, bagata, boom, boom. Now you're playing gospel. But we just slowed that down, Chuck beat that, and he incorporated in his sets. And it was that particular beat that the other bands really loved because the crowd reacted to it a particular way. And that, you know, even when Chuck first started playing it, it wasn't called go-go music. You know, back then they would say, if you was playing that style, they would say, you playing Chuck's groove. That's that groove Chuck be playing. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
That kind of thing. So even bands like the beginning bands like Rare Essence, and they all tell you Trouble, Funk, EU, they got inspired by Chuck. They would go see Chuck and love what Chuck was doing.
Right.
And even if Chuck, is it okay, can they play that style too? You know?
Wow, that's something. So I have read somewhere before and I lost the information. That there was supposedly someone before Chuck that kind of invented that sound or around that same time. Are you familiar with who that person is?
Yeah, well, I mean, there gets debates out there, some, you know, to the point where there was a group called the Young Senators. That's Jimmy Dugan, right? Jimmy Dugan's in them. I think, what's my man's name? I forget his name.
Frank Hooker.
Yeah, Frank Hooker in there.
Frank Hooker.
And, yeah. And they had a group called the Young Senators. Now, back during that time, there were a lot of bands, but some of the most popular bands were the Soul Searchers and the Young Senators. Young Senators was heavily percussive driven. I mean, you listen to their old songs like The Jungle and stuff like that. And this is why, and they were playing at these party events called go-go's. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
And this is why I think sometimes they get it confused where they think, okay, now keep in mind, okay, the Young Senators ended up becoming the backup band for Eddie Kendricks when he left the Temptations. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So probably right around the time, and you know, and Eddie Kendricks had Jones like Keep On Truckin' and Shoe Shine Boy and all the other stuff that he had back then. You know what I'm saying?
Right
around that time that they were doing that, the sound that the Soul Searchers was playing is the sound that everybody gravitated and started playing too. Like I say, it's that particular beat pattern, not just the and so that's why I mean, I got mad love for the Young Senators. I mean, I call them the precursors, the emperors of go-go, because they were part of that. They were part of that nucleus that happened before go-go. You see what I'm saying? And part of what they're doing, but their whole pattern is not the pattern that the other younger bands, when they took off with it, they didn't take off with that particular pattern. And you can play those. You can pull those songs up on YouTube, The Jungle and all, and you'll hear and you say, okay, that's real heavy percussion, just like some war stuff like that or man drill, but that's not go-go. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, that's how I would kind of debunk that, you know, I know some out there saying that. None don't get offended, but it is what it is. The truth is what it is. And even when it comes to go-go, I credit Chuck, but I always like to credit the Soul Searchers. It was Chuck. It was all of them. It was, you know, Chuck, JB, Lloyd Pinchback, and the rest of those guys. That nucleus was that sound, you know. Rick Wellman, his father, and then Rick Wellman came in on. That's Rick Wellman on the drums on Bustin' Loose at the age of, what, like 16, 17 years old. You know what I'm saying? So that Bustin' Loose is really considered the official go-go, first go-go release. Now, keep in mind, there was a whole album.
Right.
Bust and Loose wasn't on it. You know, they had the other song I used to love on it. If It Ain't Funky, Game Number 7, all that had that. But Bust and Loose, and all of it had that percussive drive, but Bust and Loose is really what had that go-go thing that everybody attached to and called go-go music.
Right. Yeah, it's funny when you were talking about with the, you know, the basic go-go beat is, and I remember being in school and everybody used to bang on bang on the your with the back and your knuckle, and they, you know what I'm saying? That was the beat, and then somebody would get on there and start playing the congos on there. On the desk, you know what I'm saying? And sometimes it would get so out of control that the teacher couldn't even stop it. You know what I'm saying? Which section, you know, because it's always a debate, which section of town would you say? I don't want to say started because we know Chuck Brown started it, but if you can understand what I'm saying, what section of town really started like the whole bands thing happening?
It was all over. I hear the debates that it started here and it started there. There were musicians all over the city. You see what I'm saying? Right. There were quite a few. I mean, you had bands like Rare Essence who resided in Southeast. Some of the members of Trouble was in Southeast. Some of them, you know what I'm saying? Some of them with the Woodson. Some Rasmus and them went to Baloo. And I think Chilla Band and them. Some of the EU went to Woodson. Some of EU are from Merrill, PG County. Sometimes I trip out when you leave out PG County because some of the early go-go spots were like the Club La Berne. And you know, one of the big spots, beginning spots for Chuck was the Ebony Inn. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So you had members from all over, and not just that, but you had bands like Mass Extinction. Mass Extinction was from uptown. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not sure. I think they may have went to Cadoza. I'm not exactly sure. But what I'm saying is that you really had musicians. When I started going to Duke Ellington, man, there were kids, all kinds of kids, and they're playing in different go-go bands. I went to Duke Ellington with Donnell Floyd. We went to school together. Harold Little. All these little cats. Harold was playing in the band. I think Harold was playing with Chance. Donnell was playing with Chance. Lil Mike was playing with Petworth. Hard Rock was playing with Peacemakers. So even in high school, that's what I'm saying. These folks were from, and up Duke Ellington, everybody was from everywhere up Duke Ellington. You know that. Because that was a real special school. So people... kids came from all over the city. So what artists, I mean, Olin and them, there was with Ovation. And I mean, so go-go artists came from everywhere, all over the city and PG County.
Right. So what made you start, and I don't know whether you profess yourself a go-go historian, but you have a lot of information and a lot of facts about go-go that a lot of people don't like. And there, like you said, there were a lot of people that came up with you. Like, what made you take the interest to start like documenting and, you know, and holding things to memory?
Well, I didn't really start documenting it until like around 96 when I started T-Mod Go-Go. By that, like 1996, but by that time I had already been playing in bands. I was with Lil Benny and the Masters for about 6 years, and they were proper utensils for another year and a half, you know, or before that. So a lot of the stuff that I'm talking about, a real super large percentage of the stuff I'm talking about, I'm going by memory. When such and such say with such and such, and I'm like, well, I was there. I remember this. Now, I may not have been. It all depends on what show it was. If I was at a particular show, like, you know, like the Ray Essence famous Highland show that took place in 1982. I wasn't there that day, but I was going to see Ray Essence back then. It, you know, it's it other right. That was their neighborhood in Highland anyway. I didn't live in Highland in Oakland, Southeast.
Right.
But at the same time, I was going to see him in places like Northwest Gardens, and especially at the Maverick Room. That's where we took out summer job money and went on Wednesday night to see Ray Essence at the Maverick. Right. You know, and this was back before 82. So
right.
a lot of stuff I'm talking about, like, and I wrote a book. Mm-hmm. I'm going to plug that.
Yes, please.
The book is called Take Me Out to the Go-Go. Right. And if you look at it, it says the story of a music culture and the impact it made in the life of one man. So this book is basically, it gives the history of go-go. And this book, I mean, you can find it on Amazon as well as like my website, CatoHammond.com. But this book gives a history of go-go through my eyes from what I remember. The stuff, like I said, you know, during the time that I was going to Duke Ellington and with Q, I was also working. My summer youth job was the summer youth employment, and working on the showmobile. So we doing stuff, you know. So I was, you know, dealing with go-go then, as well as street theater, the stuff that I was doing as well. Everything I talk about it. If I talk about when the movie Good to Go was made, I remember auditioning when they had the auditions of Howard, and the majority of the folks who played in the movie were students from Duke Ellington, like my man Chuck Bird and my teacher Linda Gravatt. You know what I'm saying? Who played the woman that horrible scene happened? That was my teacher of Duke Ellington. Her name was Linda Gravatt. So, and so my book talks about the audition problem. I remember when I didn't get the part because at the time they made the movie, I was a Bowie State at the time. And we didn't have phones and outdoors. We didn't have, so I missed the call. But Chuck got the call. He played one in the game. I remember seeing Chuck's script. Well, I remember reading Chuck's script and we laughing big time and then saying, knowing this thing ain't got nothing to do with real go-go. But it was still a good opportunity. I mean, the show's at the Capitol Center. I played at the Capitol Center with a little bit in the mess. So everything I'm talking about that were part of history of go-go was I was kind of involved in some form of fashion. Either attending or being a participant, you know.
Listen, I have to go back to a memory of that time because 82 was actually the year that I met you, right? So, so I remember. I have to bring this up. As far as Good to Go, when that movie came out, you remember we had some members of Q that wanted to go audition. and Miss Johnson forbade us to. She's like, "Well, if you do it, we will not support you." Oh yeah, she didn't. She was so against that movie for some reason, and
she
then
probably threw the script.
And then you wearing your Q T-shirt to the go-go.
That's funny because you know with Q, we weren't allowed to wear our Q outfit anyway.
Right.
And I used to wear it and the rest.
Look. Right. And then it was that picture of you and Lorraine and y'all Q shirt standing up against the go-go background.
Yeah, we were at WFC that night with the Q.
Oh my gosh, y'all got in so much trouble behind. It's so funny. Yeah.
I said we got in trouble for that. But Miss Johnson was let me point out that Miss Johnson was very lenient and supportive of me. I remember you know, during the time when I wrote the play and was having to go back and forth to New York. I mean,
yeah, wait, because I'm going to bring that up. I do want to talk about that. But, oh my gosh, I lost my train of thought.
We're talking about Good to Go. Because
I want to stick, Good to Go. So when, let's go to school days when, I guess the rest of the world found out about go-go. You know, you talk a little bit about that.
On a large, well, let's say the rest of the world found out about go-go on a larger scale. Because you gotta realize that before school days even happened, it was because of Spike's, whatever. You had to go to Sugar Bay to get the whole full detail. But basically, Spike, you know, got a whiff of EU. But remember, even before school days, EU had already done a song with Curtis Blow called Party Time. Okay?
Oh, right.
They had done Party Time. They had already did the Grace Jones Slave to the Rhythm years prior. Right. They had already done the Salt and Pepper. For, you know, well, that probably came out right before school days. Salt and Pepper, Shake Your Thing. You know what I'm saying? So that's why I say on a larger scale, because it was basically Spike Lee embracing EU and that go-go sound and putting it in the movie School Days. And of course, because it's a Spike movie, School Days, Spike was the thing at the time. Everybody, which I even remember days, everybody trying to, I even auditioned for a Spike movie one time. I remember one time trying to audition for Crook when he was throwing auditions for that. So
for what?
Crooklyn. When Spike was throwing auditions for Crooklyn. But School Days was like, came right after the whole She Gotta Have It type of thing. So if you even talk to Sugar Bear, that's when Spike kind of discovered them. Probably while in D.C. seeing EU perform somewhere, whatever, and was digging it and like that vibe. But because of the movie, the entire world, I'm going to say, really got, you know what I'm saying? I mean, it wasn't their first introduction to it, but it was on a large scale. Because Trouble had already been out there because of their association with Sugar Hill Records, you know.
Right. Yeah. I say School Days on a larger scale, because if you talk about go-go to novice, the first song they gonna say is Doing the Butt, you know.
Which is wild, because that was like in 88.
Right. I mean, of course we know it, but you know, I'll say there are some places that were familiar with go-go, like outside of D.C. Like Charlotte was on go-go like hard back in, I know, at least 86, 87, because I had a friend of my cousin's, he went to A&T down there, and he was like, y'all got to come down here and see this, because he's like, Charlotte is like, he said, it's like a little D.C.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe it. You know, you think, you know, especially back then, you think like Charlotte is probably old country town or whatever. And then when I was older and was able to go to Charlotte, I was like, wow, yeah, it really is. And I could imagine go-go fitting into that, you know, place. But then we had a conversation recently because, you know, I'm in Atlanta now and, you know, they have a go-go band here, and from what I understand, is comprised of, you know, go-go musicians that have moved from D.C. To Atlanta. But how do you feel about, like, I don't know if I'm saying it right, but about other places appropriating the music?
that's a whole nother topic. And the reason I say that's interesting and at some point sensitive topic in some areas, because I mean, it's many people want go-go to be known and recognized, you know, and that's what anybody want go-go to be known, right? So that part of it where it gets known and recognized is cool. We just want to be, I think folks want to be careful that even in you can't stop anything from being appropriated, but even you want to make sure that it's correct where it comes from. And you and in all honesty, if anybody blew up big with it, I'm sure many people feel, and this is how I personally feel, if anybody, I would hope it would be someone from the go-go culture first. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
To really to, you know what I'm saying? And I think it is hitting in that direction. I think people will probably have an issue with it if you have an artist out there that blew up with it and did an Elvis to it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And that, you know, right. I think that would be a problem. But one thing you got to also keep in mind is just music and is music. And once the door is open, it's for grabs for anybody who absorbs it. So you can't help. A person from New York can't help if they love Memphis blues. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
It may not be right. from Memphis, but they just love it and they absorb it. And it becomes part of them right. when they put in their music. That's art. Right. You know what I'm saying? Right. I just hope that, you know, when it really get to it, it's finally almost semi in the category to receive a Grammy for and being able to call it go-go in a right. sense, even though it's still under umbrella, it would be kind of hurtful if someone after we're talking over 40 years to right. have the first person to ever win a Grammy not be an actual artist from the culture.
Right. You know? Right.
But as far as it being appropriate, there's nothing we could do to stop it. Money talks with anything.
You know? Right. Well, you know what? I will say, like, some of the bigger artists who have, like, dabbled in it, you know, let's talk about, like, for instance, like Jill Scott. She gives, like, mad respect. Yeah. And I think, you know, that makes the difference. You know what I'm saying? But like when you see these videos online, I think I had sent you one before. And it was like, it wasn't really hitting. They was trying, you know what I'm saying?
But see, sometimes, now if you see a video of a band playing a song by a go-go band as a cover song, they don't even, especially, I think I seen one, it was a white group, you know, I don't know if you can see, I don't know if they were, the spot they were playing, it seemed like it could have been at the country or western spot, Juke Joint or something like that, but they were playing during the butt, and right. or Sardines, that's another one, and right. and in the places, I don't even know if they realize they playing go-go. They just playing another cover right. song that was popular like any other cover song that was popular.
Right.
So
right,
I'm not expecting to get that whole go-go vibe from them. It's just cute to see, wow, that's pretty cool that they, you know, they playing a song that was created by a go-go band. They may not even right. know. Because like I say, right. even go-go songs, even me, I've been sitting for the past few years, I've been releasing music. When I release music and stuff, I just released the album. The album is called Inner City Grooving. It's a go-go album. I got to say it's a go-go album because when I'm submitting it to these platforms like Spotify and Apple Music and Tidal and all that kind of stuff, and you got to put what categories in, go-go is still not listed. I mean, when I announced that I released a go-go album, a guy hit me up and said, I can't find it on... I don't see it on Apple Music. I said, yeah, it's up there. Then he said, oh, wait a minute, I found it. It's listed under R&B. Because when we submit music, we got to even put it in the category of R&B or funk. Because go-go isn't
right.
one of the categories they give the options for you to have just yet. So that's something that's hopefully will come into fruition real soon.
Well, when I pull, on Spotify, actually, because sometimes, you know, I just miss home so bad, you know, and it's so funny, you know, I'll put on, like, I've actually typed in go-go music on Spotify, and it'll bring stuff up, but then it'll switch to, like, something that's just totally not in the right. genre. I mean, I've had it turn into gospel music before, but you know, it is interesting to see the reactions. You know, I drive Uber and Lyft, so just looking in that rear view mirror and looking, you know, just to see the reactions of the people, you know. And they have, you could tell some of them just have no clue what's coming out the speaker. And so I mean, if I'm like really in the zone and I just can't turn it off, I'll say, you know, the music, is the music too much? No, it's okay, it's all right. You know. But I just the last thing I want to talk about on GoGo, and this was really short, so we might have to come back and revisit this whole conversation. And
Okay.
you know, maybe even bring on some of the you know, music go-go musicians, and we do like a double interview.
That'd
You
be
could
cool. Yeah,
co-host with me. But and you know, one person just shout out to Tony from Big Tony from Trouble Funk, and we sending up our prayers for him right now because
prayers
he's in the
to him.
hospital.
He just went to church and he's
But
praying.
he's always been somebody that's very approachable. I remember when I went and bought that album, Pump, 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 Pump Me Up. He was actually at the, because he used to hang out at Iverson Mall at that little Kent Mill downstairs, you know, Waxy Maxies or whatever it was downstairs. So every time I went, he was there, you know what I'm saying? And that's one thing that I can say about Tony. He is gonna always promote his music, his bands, you know what I'm saying? That's something that has never changed throughout the years. And I just want to give him a shout out tonight, especially with all that he's going through. But the last thing that I want to talk about, and we talked about this a while ago, and we probably have to do the bridge version of it, but you know how they talk about associating, especially back in the 80s, the violence with that goes along with go-go. And you know, I've worked in bars, I bartended and stuff like that, and you know, it was just, you know, on those nights, it really is just kind of like you are really a little bit on edge waiting to see if something gonna I'm sorry, pop off for the evening. But you gave me a whole different perspective on, you know, quote unquote violence with the go-go community. Can you just expound on that a little bit?
Well, sometimes I hate, or I don't agree with the title, quote unquote, violence being associated with go-go community. Man, violence is just, golly, just, I mean, we just had a crazy incident that happened yesterday on the 4th, you know, in Chicago. It's, you know, and it has nothing, and that had nothing to do with go. That had no more to do with the 4th of July parade than a violence that may have taken place outside of a go-go event or whatever had to do with the go-go. You see what I'm saying? It's just one of those things. We sadly, we in such a violent society where it seems people look at violence first to resolve whatever. I mean, it's just to the point where it's, I'm not saying people like it, but it's, it, people have almost become, I ain't gonna say numb to it, but it's just like, I mean, the hottest video games are violent video games. You know, the hottest shows and movies and the hottest TV programs, reality shows are the ones that they're fighting and beefing all the time on. So it,
YouTube fight videos and all
yeah,
that.
you know what I'm saying? It's just that type of frame of mind, and you know, how can I say it? As well as it may happen in go-go, it may happen. I mean, it does, not just may, it does happen anywhere. Go-go happens to be, and for the longest time, a real popular event. You know what I'm saying? Real popular events that take place. When it comes to popular events, everybody goes to what's popular. People come to have a good time, and some who may not come to have a good time, unfortunately. You know what I'm saying? If go-go had never existed, Would that violence not have existed? It would have taken place somewhere else, at a skating rink or wherever people drink and don't get along or have a beef with someone or whatever. It's just a sad case in society, period. And I just be wishing sometimes that when it gets talked about, it gets talked about in that light and not just saying, okay, go-go draws violence. Nobody in the go-go band, I can tell you any go-go band tell you they hate it with a passion that violence break out. If it break, and yeah. it hasn't broken out in a long time. I know the incident that happened, but that was probably an uncontrolled environment. When you got an uncontrolled environment in an open space like that, anything can happen. Like I said, just like it did in Chicago. Unfortunately, that's the sad thing about today's society, because we talk about it today and tomorrow we are talking about something else until the next thing happens.
Would it be reasonable to say maybe not so much now as in the 80s that you had to consider your safety when you were going to
anywhere? You had to consider your safety. That's what I'm saying.
I know, but would there be an extra expectation that you need? Because, for instance, my parents wouldn't let me go. My cousins and them could go, and they wouldn't let us stay out past a certain time because of that fear. I remember a girl in my eighth grade class, they rented out Cherries, and she had a band, and I was so mad. My mother was like, if you go, you have to leave at 11 o'clock. That's how my mother would talk. She'd ball her lip up. She'd be like, you got to leave at 11 o'clock. And I was like, dang, the band don't even come on to 12. She's like, I said 11. You know what I'm saying? There were a lot of shootings, and then you had to, drug culture that kind of attached their self to that in the 80s. And I guess my question to you back there, when we were having this discussion before, is there some kind of forum or something? Could the go-go community, the musicians come together? Like I said, it don't happen so much now as it did back then, but could it be prevented by them taking a more proactive step as far as opening their voice? Because like I was telling you then, there was a band that was playing at the bar that I was working at. And then, all they would do was just stop and then let the security. But I just felt like if the head of the band, because their words are power. If he hadn't just stopped and just stood back, and like you said, it was one of those things where you could see on his face it was getting on his nerves. But I just felt like he could have spoke up and said, I think that would have resonated.
Some have done. Let me say two things. Some have done that. For example, I don't know if you saw, when they had the event, and it wasn't a go-go event, but they had the event a couple of weeks ago, the Something in the Water thing that Pharrell, brought to the city. And it was all these artists. Well, you may not have been here, but the events were shown on live on Amazon Prime. Anyway, Backyard did play on as one of the artists on it, right? Mm-hmm,
right.
And one of the things that Genius, Big G, however you refer to him, Antoine Glover, one of the things he did, which he always do, as they perform, before he left the stage, he said, to stop the violence, to stop the killing each other, let's start loving each other. Then they You know what I'm saying? Then they've been you know, could things be done? You know, I've mentioned one time, I can't remember, in a meeting or something, it would be cool if a campaign, like, say, for example, a real big promo campaign where some of these most well-known artists, I'm going to say the lead talkers, because they're the front face that people really recognize with, of these go-go bands. It would be cool, like, on the metro buses and on the signs, you see image of them, you know, proclaiming. That makes it look like they're being proactive
right,
about it.
Right.
You know,
You know, y'all mayor don't like mumbo sauce, so she probably not going to go for that.
Nothing she can do to stop that, but what I'm saying is that it's not that the artists aren't proactive about it. It's just the public don't know that they may be proactive about it. So sometimes doing this, I don't mean to create a smoke and mirrors thing, but sometimes you're doing this so they can know that the artists in go-go are against it just as much as they are. Now keep in mind, a person is going to do something, is going to, regardless, for example, there's an old video that KRS-One did years ago with a song called Love's Gonna Get You, right? Mm. And in that video, he's going, you know, Love's Gonna Get You. And he's talking about how they would sit around and on the TV, that commercial would come on, you know, this is drugs, this is your brain on drugs, and it's frying an egg or something like that. And he, in the rap, he talking about how a drug dealer would actually turn that video off because there's no concern to him. And you know, so I do believe in the artists being proactive as much as they can. And I think they are. They in these marches. You see DJ Rico, and they're doing these marches and something. So I think they are being proactive. But I like the idea of the billboards with, like, if you got gangers on a billboard, if you got rapper from Northeast Grooves on a billboard, or Bug from Junkyard, or whoever, you know, or Killer Cal or Funk or any of them. And you see a billboard, just like the billboard to say, we want you to join the army, a billboard saying, please stop the violence and increase the peace. Stay and love your brother. Chuck Brown always talked about preaching love to one another. Always.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I mean,
and then, but that's the other part of it. You knew, like, when you were going to a Chuck event, it was a different caliber. You did go into some of the other bands.
People were older. The people were older at Chuck's stuff. You know what I'm saying? But unfortunately, you know, things have happened there as anywhere else, you know, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, like I say, it's not even that it'll happen there. It'll happen after it's over. Somebody got a beef with somebody. And they know if you got the hottest event going on in town and you got a beef with somebody, it's like somebody got beef with somebody, well, I know they're gonna be here, so let me go a bit because I don't, that's where they're gonna be, and they can't find a person nowhere else. They're gonna find them whatever the hottest thing going on in the city is. I bet chances are that person is gonna be there. You got unfortunate, sad, and like I say, that was then, because I can't even remember the last time I've really heard any incidents happening in the go-go, you know what I'm saying, in all honesty. Because the people, people are older now.
Right.
These go-go folks ain't kids no more. The kids ain't even into it. Like, unless it's an outside event or something. You know?
Yeah. So that's we're gonna wrap it up on go-go, and if we could take, maybe, I know we are going over time and we had that little glitch in the beginning. So if I could get about 15 or 20 minutes from you just to talk about you. So one of my proudest moments of you, and, you know, first of all, like, I get so excited, like, about your accomplishments a lot of times. The first time I actually saw you, like, I didn't realize that, like, you were so on that scene until 1990 when I was going to UDC and they did some kind of homecoming event, and you were playing, I think, with Proper Utensils at the time.
In 90, I was with Lil Benny and the Masters.
Okay, okay. Yes, so you were there, and you were just hanging around the stage unassuming. I'm like, wait, what you doing here? And then I saw you up on the stage. I was like, what? You know what I'm saying? And I didn't know all of this time that you were playing. But like I said, even before then, like, you were on the road to, like, some major things. And one of the things that I always tell about you to folks that I've run into that know you and stuff, I said, you know, Kato wrote a play back in the day. And I want you to just kind of talk about that. And how you went about that, and then who were some of the actors and
okay. That sort of thing. Well, yeah, I was about 17. I was still in Cue. I wasn't. Mm-hmm. I was no longer a student at Duke. I was only at Duke Ellington for like a year and a half. Mm-hmm. And but it, by the age of 17, I was going to school out in Maryland, Bowie High School. But it's the weirdest thing is that I was still very heavily active in Cue. And when I got to Bowie High School out in Maryland, and I got into, because I was in theater at Duke, I got into the theater programs at Bowie, and I was known as a guy from Duke. So they held me on high regard from the moment I got there, simply because I went to Duke Ellington. Mm-hmm. Right, so during that time, a student approached me to talk about a playwright contest they have in New York. You should enter, write a play. And I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna write a play. So I wrote a play. The play, believe it or not, was about three guys who went to the go-go. You know what I'm saying? So, but I wrote the play.
Harry Poe didn't do that?
No, Harry Poe came later.
Okay.
Yeah, Harry Poe came later. So, So I wrote the play, and the play, it was for a young playwriters festival in New York that they held nationwide. Now, all the submissions they got, they get thousands of submissions, they break it down to their top 11. I was one of the top 11. So I got to go to, so what that means is I was going back and forth to New York because they was rehearsing my play as a readings and was going to do them off Broadway.
Right.
And to keep in mind, I'm a 17-year-old kid. I'm going back and forth to New York. I'm staying with people, you know, and as they bring in people, like, I remember the first day that we got there, and it was a black woman. Her name was Billie Eilish. God rest her soul. She was in the movie The Wiz. She played one of the family members in the very beginning. But anyway, Billie Eilish was, you know, heavily known in New York on the theater scene, and she was directing it. She was telling me about the people they had casting it. And keep in mind, like I said, I'm 17, so she bringing people, and those people like come in. It was people like Anna Marie Hosford. And people know Anna Marie Hosford for, like, she played in the TV show Amen, and she played Craig's father mother in the Friday series and all that.
Right.
I'm keeping in mind, this is long before all that happened. Other folks come in, a comedian named Jeffrey Joseph. I still see him today. They were young then. There was another guy another guy named Michael Wright. Michael Wright, later on, he's mostly known as Eddie King from the movie Five Heartbeats.
Right.
So Michael Wright was another guy. They kept talking about how this guy was going to blow the hell up one day. He was everybody's favorite. Everybody was like, watch this dude blow up. And that was Denzel Washington. And keep in mind, once again, none of them had really done anything. They were on the theater scene in New York. If I'm 17, that means Denzel was between 25 and 27 himself.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And we did the play. You know, I got to meet people like, you know, Felicia Rashad and all that kind of stuff. And I think at the time Felicia was doing All My Children, and but anyway, you know, so we're doing my play, we're going back and forth, we're doing my play, and of course later on you know, some of the people blew up. I think the movie Soldier Story with Denzel Washington came out maybe 2 or 3 years later. And, you know, that's when he started blowing up. Then how Harry Polk got into it, this was a couple of years later, you know, I'm back home in, you know, in D.C. and all that. And we got to have it, make it official that my play was like, you know, Summer Youth Employment again, right? So we was able, through Harry Poe, I think Harry Poe helped get this done. He had to, you know, through the D.C. Department of Recreation, the production of my play was going to be a summer job for a bunch of teens.
Right.
So Harry Poe was the director of that. He directed it then. It was the same play that I had done a couple of years prior up in New York, but it was just never here, which was directed by Harry Poe, which was, you know, which was really cool. I brought up Miss Johnson from Q, because I remember during that time I was in Q, so I was having to go back and forth to New York, and I would come back and then come to the Q rehearsals, and she was, and first of all, I was so inspired. Miss Johnson meant so much to me, so much to me, that I wrote a character in my play based on her. As a matter of fact, Anna Marie Hoffa played Miss Johnson in my play, who happened to be a director of a children's theater group. Right. So I wrote Miss Johnson in my play.
Wow.
I think she may have knew that or whatever, but she was always behind me and very, very supportive during that period. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Which is probably why I didn't get as in that much trouble wearing my cute t-shirt to the go-go.
Right. That, I mean, every time, I mean, I could have, you might be able to see, well, I can't put my arm up there, but I got chill bumps, like literally every time I think about that, you know, like you were at 17 years old, you know, part of the building blocks of these people's careers, you know what I'm saying? And that's major, you know.
I always wondered if I ever ran into Denzel, would he remember me? I bet he would, because even though I haven't run into him, I've run into some of the other actors, and they do remember. I've ran into them like on Facebook and stuff, and they was like, "Oh yeah, I remember you." Yeah, you know.
Right. Well, you know, I'm definitely gonna do a split of this video and tag him in it. So you know.
Oh yeah, I want to see.
And then I know you probably have other ideas. You have other play ideas or TV ideas? I mean, because you're so creative, do you have other ideas? You just kind of.
Yeah, I've written all kinds. I'm in the middle of writing two books actually. One is a fiction, and one is another book on the history of go-go. And I'm doing that in collaboration with Charles Stevenson and Ilona Wachowski. But even when I wrote Buddies back then, when a girl came to me telling me about the Young Playwriters Contest, the only reason I had something, because I had already started writing it anyway. So that just gave me a reason. That just gave me a reason to finish it and send it in. I didn't expect to win nothing. One of the things they said they would do is you would get a critique on it. So I just sent it in to get a critique on my playwright. But other stuff, but nothing has been done or produced anything like that.
Right. Do you think because you said it was, the play was sort of like, the play was sort of like Boys in the Hood before Boys in the Hood.
Yeah, it really was. It was about three guys. They had, and I'm gonna tell you who I based the characters on. And you know them. Everybody I based the characters on was me, Chuck Berg, and George Dick. Those were my friends at the time. They were my close friends at the time. So one of the characters was based on George. One of the characters was based on Chuck. One of the characters was based. I don't even know if they even knew that, now that I think about it. And it's funny because when we did the play in D.C. With the Harry Poe behind it, George and Chuck were part of the that production. They didn't play the characters. Right. They didn't play the characters that was based on them necessarily. But
right.
So I don't think they have, even to this day. I will, if they see this, they may say, damn, I didn't know that. But yeah.
But you know, let's talk about Harry Poe for just a moment, because, mm-hmm. you know, I remember when he came in and Miss Johnson introduced him to us, and she was saying that he had worked with a lot of famous people, and mm-hmm. and so you know me, I mean, I was only like 10 at 10 or right. 11.
You were one of the young, I was a little one of the older but, kids, you were one of the younger kids,
right? So, you know, of course, you know, I wanted to know who. So can you tell us who are some of the famous people you work with?
Me?
And he, no.
You talking about Harry, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
And he said Debbie Allen, and, you know, I wanted to be on Fame, so, you know, that was everything when I heard right. that, you right. know. but, you know, I recently, probably, I'm going to say maybe 2 months ago, I reached out to Isaiah Washington on Facebook, and you know, Harry Poe was a mentor to Isaiah Washington.
I never knew that.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, because I have read an article, and it had his name, and I was like wondering if it was the same one. So I asked him, and he said, "Yeah, we had a small little conversation about Harry." So then, when you know, you're looking at. The other night I was watching Girl 6, and I was like, wow, you know, I don't know when Harry passed away, but it had to be, you know, I mean, when Girl 6, it had to still kind of be fresh, you know? And so it was just, you know, just watching the stuff and just thinking about the time period, you know, it's like, wow, where it all kind of intersects. You know, it's just amazing yeah. and stuff. So I did want folks to know that little trivia about you. And now I want you to talk about, you do so many other things. We discussed you being an author, and then you mm-hmm. being a musician. You make websites, you know, you do graphics. I want to know what else you might do that we don't. No, and then
I guess that's probably the realm of it. Those things. I just like I enjoy staying in a creative mode, being able to create in whatever ways possible is what keeps me happy, balanced, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
You know. I don't know, just something I've been, you know. So I don't even count, you know. I just, whatever I kind of in the mood to try to do, I just, you know, I'm a DIY type of guy anyway. I'm a do-it-yourself right. type of guy anyway. I mean, I wanted to do a documentary on the T-Margogo thing.
Mm.
But one thing I learned from Duke, one thing, and us doing my play, you know, with Harry Poe and stuff, I've never been a fan of auditions, right? Yeah. I've never, and the reason being, because, man, you can get worked up, and, you know, when you go to an audition place, then you see like 150 other people going for that role. That would knock my groove. So I was always involved with folks who would do stuff ourselves. Like I right. mentioned, Chuck George and us, when we did my play, we did that ourselves.
Right.
We were, you know, I figure if you're doing it yourself, then you ain't got to worry about the auditioning part.
Right. And that is the thing. And then, you know, I mean, I'm starting to find it here, and I guess it's anywhere. It's always a click and who you know. And I'm the same way. I'm not a proponent for the cattle calls. I'm not standing in nobody's line. I don't mean no harm. I'm not that hungry, you know. So
and it isn't that I think I'm all this and all that, because I don't
right,
think that
right, 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 right. Yeah, it's not that. It's just, you know, and but for me though, and people can say what they want to about Mr. Tony Terry. After I understudied Tony Terry in Mike Malone's last production of Black Nativity, there, I don't care what it is, it's just certain things that I won't do, you know. When
I
you
can
get to
understand. I can,
you
you know, I know Tony. Tony was another one to Duke Ellington with and worked in street theater. I worked with Mike Malone in street theater. So, yeah, you know, I know both. But so I understand if you worked in a Mike Malone production, I understand exactly what you're saying with that.
I don't mean no harm, but I'm just not gonna do your Sunday, you know, Sunday in the church basement play. I'm just not gonna happen, you know. And it's like every time you may give somebody a little wiggle room to do something like that, it's like it always for me turns into a disaster. You know what I'm saying? Because it's like, you know, the stuff ain't it, we were trained, you know, we were trained on the best, you know what I'm saying? You know, just quick off the record thing. So, you know, Tony Bird that did the lighting for us for Q. So I found out recently that he worked with Millie Jackson. He was working with her when we were in Q, based on the timeline. I've been able to befriend Keisha Jackson, which is Millie's daughter, and I mentioned him because he had mentioned her. He came to my open mic when I was hosting open mic in DC, and he had mentioned Keisha, you know, and Keisha and I were already friends on Facebook, but it just made me connect with her in a stronger way. And so, you know, we've always been kind of moving in those circles, and that just brings it back to the point, you know, once you kind of move in a certain realm, it's just certain things. I guess maybe that may be the reason why, you know, Ms. Johnson was so opposed to Q folks going and audition for
Which I can understand. I mean, I totally understand.
Because, you know, but yeah, so I had this one last question for you, and we're gonna wrap it. Well, my last question, then the question that we ask at the end of every episode. So I wanted to ask you, as a musician, which instruments do you play? Because when I saw you back at UDC for that homecoming, you were doing percussion for that show.
I can do percussion, guitar, drums. I've been a drummer for my church for the past many years. I'm self-taught everything, basically. Well, I call it self. I mean, I learn from folks, but you know what self-taught means. I haven't had formal training, not musically and stuff. I had formal training in theater, but theater stuff, but not music stuff. I just absorbed musically and just, you know, from the people I grew up around and learned, you know, picked up from them and did sit in the room doing my homework. That's what it really is, you know.
So I lied. I had another question. What's next for you? And then also, if you could give your, like, you know, information on how they can contact you for like any of your services. And
Well, like I said, I got two books I'm kind of working on. The one we're working on, like I said, is a more in-depth history of Go-Go book. It's entitled Crankin', The Essential Guide to a DC Music Culture. And that's I'm co-authoring that with two other authors, Charles Stevenson, who actually was a co-author of the book, a Go-Go book called The Beat. And he also used to manage EU years ago and all that. And also Alona Wachowski is her name. She's been writing for the Washington Post for probably since the '80s, and she's always, you know, covered Go-Go, and she writes many stuff for the city paper now. So we're in a collab doing that, which is being published by Georgetown Publishing. So that and like I say, the fiction book is the one I'm working on. Should have been finished. I should have been finished a few years ago, but I kind of had put it on the shelf doing other stuff, and I'm gonna finish. I want to get that out as well. So those are the things I'm working on. Like I said, I just did music. I just released the album. I did release an album last year called Go-Go Music Matters.
Right.
And I submitted it for a Grammy nod, you know, for consideration for Grammy nod. It got to the stage where it was placed on the ballot to be considered, but that's as far as it went. Right. But you know, and the album I just released a couple of weeks ago called Inner City Grooving, under the name of Kato and the Alley Cats, Inner City Grooving, which I'll be trying again, tip my hand again for a Grammy nod again this year.
Mm.
So that's kind of currently what I'm going as far as contacts. Everywhere. I mean, Instagram. I'm Kato Hammond. Instagram. You know, slash Kato Hammond. I'm at Kato Hammond Instagram. I'm Kato Hammond on Facebook. Kato Hammond on Twitter, and then you can visit my own website, which is katohammond.com, and as well as the T-Mod Go-Go. Take me out to the Go-Go websites that I still continually do. I've been doing that. Not really printing magazines like I used to, but I still been doing the T-Mod Go-Go thing. It's been 26. It's since about 26 years since 1996. So still doing that. So that's kind of what I'm doing.
So wait a minute. I'm sorry, all these questions keep coming up, but I'm not going to say your government, but like, you know, I knew you as your government, and then when did Kato come in?
That came during the time I was started playing with Lil Benny and the Masters. I started playing with Lil Benny and the Masters around the later part of 1988, around going into 89, and that nickname was, you know, picked up then. You know, Go-Go, everybody got a nickname in Go-Go.
Right, right. So you was Kato before the O.J. Simpson trial?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. I thought maybe...
Oh, yeah. No, not named after him. I would assume if anybody, but named after the Bruce Lee character from Green Hornet, you know?
Oh, okay. His name was Kato, because I'm not familiar.
Oh, he's the original Kato. Kato, you don't know about Green Hornet and Kato?
No.
Okay, look at him. I mean, Seth Grogan did a remake and it sucked. But back in the late 60s and 70s, you remember Batman and Robin had a show?
Right.
Batman and Adam West and Burt Ward.
Right.
Well, Green Hornet and Kato was a show like Batman and Robin. They wore masks, and the Green Hornet and Kato was it was played by Bruce Lee. So that lets you know how old it is.
Right.
Kato was played by Bruce Lee, and he even Google it up, and you'll see the picture of Kato. He wearing all black because he was kind of like, I forgot Green Hornet's real name because they were heroes. And Kato was kind of like his butler.
Right.
His chauffeur.
Right.
But he was the one, and of course he had that karate one. Kato was, anybody who watched Green Hornet and Kato, they watched it because of Kato, not because of Green Hornet.
Right.
Bruce Lee would be kicking ass, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So, hey, look, I thought that wasn't about, so that's where it came from. It didn't come from Kato Katelyn of the OJ.
Right. Okay, so That's about it. This man has been quoted in the African American Museum. Yeah, like, he's been on TV One on behind, what's it, the Unsung series. Yeah. You know, if you can't remember anything, just Google Kato Hammond. It'll all come up. And I want to ask you the last question that we ask on every Or every show, who is your celebrity crush?
My celebrity crush. Wow. My homegirl. I love myself some Taraji, man.
Really? Yeah. I thought you was going. I just knew you were going to say Janet Jackson.
Janet Jackson is number one.
Right.
I mean, man, when it comes to Janet Jackson, she's on a whole nother. Now, keep in mind, Janet is a year younger than me. So right. During the time when she was a penny on Good Times, I used to keep a picture of her in my wallet as right. Penny.
Right.
I mean, you know, Janet is my baby. Okay.
Right. Right. Baby. Is that a real picture or did you Photoshop that?
No, that's a real picture. That was around the time when she came out with the album Demeter Joe. Remember that album?
Right. But I always thought that picture was Photoshop. It don't look like y'all.
Right. No, people even say why your eyes look wide. Well, no, my eyes do that when flash hits.
Right.
So we were at a gathering. If you look at the whole picture, I'm right. holding some papers and stuff in my hand. Oh, and yeah. there are other people with her. My arm is around her, but right. there are other people on the other side of her, like my man Preston Blue. You know what I'm saying? He's right. in the picture as well. And
you cropped him out, huh?
Yeah, just for this purpose. I mean, I still got right. the whole picture.
Right.
And I got another picture because at the time, that's when she was dating Jermaine Dupri. So I have another picture with me. He was standing over there. So I got another picture with us two as well.
Right.
But we were working on promoting the Demeter Joe album. That's where that came. There's a crop picture. There's a crop picture. You know the picture of her with the hands covering her chest?
Right. Right.
Now, I did create a crop picture where I stuck my head, making it look like it's me with my hands
right.
on her head.
Right.
And I cropped the picture of Sanaa Lathan. She's another one I love. You know, right. Sanaa Lathan. But Taraji just, you know, Taraji, Janet, yeah, but Taraji just do it for me. You know.
Right. I can't explain right. why. Right.
Maybe because she acts so DC. You know,
right, right.
Even a baby yeah. boy, I'm like, that chick out of D.C.
Right, 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 right. Yeah, I could go on with stories even about the first time I met Taraji, but we're going to get ready to... Really? Really? Well, we're going to get ready to get out of here. My celebrity crush always, forever, is Shaquille O'Neal and his crusty feet, and we are going to... And get on out here to the next time. Get the biscuits while they're hot. Catch a rising star. Peace.